if you know he's turning around, how you say, hey, say the name.
His church. He said, I need y'all to sit over here. I got to go down to this garden and don't get camera up. He said, my sweat actually don't look like blood. It's gone. Because I got a lot that's on my shoulder right now. I have committed one sin. But I got to put the sins of the whole world on my shoulders. I haven't betrayed anybody. But I'm about to be betrayed by people I love. And it's a lot to deal with. And I got to go down to this garden and have a little talk with my daddy. Mm-hmm. All I need y'all to do is just keep an eye out for me. Keep your eyes open. And it says that he, in verse 40, it says when he returned, he found them snoring. I got to go and go through all this. All I ask y'all to do is stay away. Just keep your eyes open. Stay aware of what's going on. That y'all couldn't even stay away for an hour. How selfish is that? This man getting ready to bear the sins of the world. I mean, he's getting ready to die for not his own sins, but he's getting ready to die for all the mess I did. He didn't know what I did. He's getting ready to die for all the mess you did. He's getting ready to die for all the mess they did. And he come back and they bent over and call to sleep.
Yeah, the story, bro. You get it right.
He said to Peter,
yes, sir.
I know you always do want to jump out there. You cut a jump of here off of me. I know you're a fighter. You talking good game. Talking good game.
I like
where you're going. But you're storing right with me. You got dirt running down your mouth, too. You're supposed to be the fighter, my ride or die.
Yes, sir.
And you're sleeping with the rest of them. Say, Peter, you, not even you could stay awake and keep your eyes open for an hour? In my opinion, if Jesus returned today, just my opinion, I'm just
here it comes.
A little fella from Gainesville, Florida. You know, regular family, regular neighborhood. But in my opinion, I'm not a scholar, I'm not a theologian, but in my opinion, if he returned today, he would find the majority of our churches in our community sleeping. He'd find us sleeping. I guess it would be more appropriate to call it sleepwalking, because they're actually doing stuff. Making a whole lot of movement, whole lot of stuff going on, but sleeping. More excited about praise and bodily exercise, which gives the appearance of religion, but rarely having similar excitement about consistently serving and empowering the less fortunate and downtrodden in our community. Let me just bring, I'm gonna just be real with you. And probably ain't nobody gonna like the sermon.
Be real, bro.
That's fine.
Be real, bro.
We get in church and do all this running and jumping and sweating and looking deep and dressing all, trying, looking like we the Pope. I mean, we just drip over. We got it. I see some of this stuff preachers well. I don't know what to call them out. I don't know. We dressed all up, just look like dignity. And folk in the church go by a car. And we cut their credit, 500. Now they've had 30% interest. And the car go get took. I'm not supposed to say it another way, but it's going to get took. Because now I'm paying two times more than a car on a car. that it's worth it, that I should be paying. And I'm already taking advantage of my situation because this is not the only one. Is there every other thing I got to get out and get some help with? They killing me, but I'm more excited about running around and shouting than maybe a whole bit of an 8-month core to help build the credit so you don't have to become enslaved to debt. Get more excited about jumping around and doing all the latest religious looking stuff. I mean, just be honest with me, y'all. I know what we're supposed to do. Oh, everybody, love the Lord, praise the Lord. I know all that. I know all that. But just how many of y'all been to a gas station this week? A few. That one time you went, did you spend more than 15 minutes there? How many people spent more than 15 minutes? Nobody. All churches is a gas station. Come get your gas. Come fill up. And now go do the work. Come back and fill. But the way we done twisted this thing, it's all about the jump and the shout. All about the latest new dance. All about the latest new clothes. And we just come and hide behind these windows and just sit in the gas station and then wait till the next time we come sit behind these windows and sit in the gas station. Nobody don't just go sit in the gas station. You get the gas to go do the work. After all the jumping and shouting, is your people like it better? Is it improving a little bit? Are you teaching good stewardship? Are you teaching accountability? Or do you have your children answering the phone? My mom said, "Tell you she ain't home." That's lying right there. Go be honest. Get on the phone. Hey, I'm in a bad place right now, but I'm working in my church. We're going to get this thing together. We're going to get y'all one day. Can't get you now, but I ain't going to lie to you. But I'm going to get this straight. I kind of run. I veered off to the left, veered off to the right. I'm getting up. Don't teach your children how to lie. How to shirk responsibilities. Be responsible. You dug the hole. Amen. All right, now work your way out of it. But don't teach your folk around you how to shirk responsibilities and not be responsible. God can't bless you when you're being shaded. Amen. You gotta be real. I'm a living witness. Amen. Tough times come. I'm talking everybody's spirit, but how do you deal with the difficult times? And church ought to be a place that helps people become better. That empowers people. I ain't just talking about the dance and the shout. That ain't nothing. I got bad. Anyway, I'm gonna give you on a good day. I might give you 45 seconds. You have a good shot. Then you're gonna see me reach down to my seat because I'm just gonna get tired. But that ain't what it's about anyway. It's about what do we do when we leave this place. Amen. What kind of parents am I being?
Yes, sir.
Am I training my child up to only appreciate stuff? When I bless my child, am I blessing my child with something that empowers their mind, that can help them be successful in this world? Or am I teaching them to only get excited about $200 shoes that ain't worth but $20? Am I leaving an inheritance and a legacy for my family? Or do I have a jacked up mentality of I worked hard for mine? And they gonna have, what kind of sense is that to make them start from the bottom? If you start from the bottom, why your children gotta start from the bottom? That means generation ain't going nowhere, stuck in the cycle. You worked your way up. You started here, bless your child to start here, now your grandchild can start here, and then you can actually start owning some things. Talk about generational wealth. But guess who should teach that? churches when we couldn't, when they were burning down our businesses. And they wouldn't give us insurance. Guess who started the insurance companies? Churches. When we couldn't go to school that everyone else could go to, a higher education, guess who started our colleges? Churches.
That's right.
We got the juice in the church. We got the juice. We know how to make this thing work. But when we've been deceived in the thing that it's all about a jump, a shout, a hat, and a suit. The world is looking. Where is the power base? And the power base in the soup store trying to get their sock game on. I don't know nobody where. So focused on new phrases like relationship, we good with these phrases. But God's concerned about relationship, not religion. Yeah, that sounds real good, but what are you doing for others? That's good you got your relationship down.
Amen.
But how your relationship going to expand the kingdom?
Amen.
That's good you got your relationship down. I mean, folks hear you, folks are distracted too. If you get caught on phrases, folks, they are phraseology kings and queens. They got doctorates in phraseology. But you got to look beyond the phrase. It's about relationship, not religion. But your relationship with God ought to cause you to step out there and help empower somebody else. Why you let that young lady, you know what she's going through. You know what she's suffering with. You know how she, because you had the struggle. You got a little bit. Help her. You want to talk about what her child looked like? You want to talk about how her child had not done? You want to talk about what the child's shoes look like? Well, why don't you do this right here? Go pick the whole family up. Take them shopping. Tell them to get what they want to get. Then you ain't got nothing else to say. It's about empowerment. You don't have the right kind of clothes. Well, guess what? When he goes to the interview, he's going to wear what you see. If you don't think he has the right kind of clothes to be able to get a job, quit talking.
Amen.
The church is about more than what we've been deceived into thinking that we're about. We're about gas. We think we're about gas station ministry. No. We're about people building, community building, ministry. The gas station is just to help us empower the community. Yeah, I can't do the work without the gas. I gotta come to church. That's why the Bible says, forsake not the assembling together of yourselves. I gotta come to church to get it. But when I get it, I gotta take the folk that need it. Gotta make it. The biggest witness for our ministry is for just to be able to one day say, you know what, this year, 2018, January, the average credit of our ministry was 680. But you know what, 2 years later, after we focused on being disciplined and improving our credit, now in 2020, the average credit score is 740. Now that's real ministry right there. Look at health ministry and say, hey, when we look at our blood pressure, and I don't really know those numbers right there, but our average blood pressure, it was a low bad number, but we've been focusing on eating right. We're going to put all the pig feet down. We're going to put all the stuff down to kill you. And we've been focusing on eating right. And now blood pressure is in line. That's real ministry right there. Yes. Children are getting A's and B's in school. That's real ministry right there. But the church has been tricked into gas station ministry. Sleeping. And we those of you that attend Bible studies, we have witnessed that God revealed this reality week after week for the past several months as we studied the period of Judges. Sleeping. Folks sleeping when they ought to be watching. Verse 41a, the scripture says, keep alert or watch and pray. That's what Jesus told Peter. Peter, watch and pray. Both are needed. We got to watch and we got to pray. Both are needed so that we will not fall into temptation. We got the praying part nailed down. We got that. We'll pray at the drop of a dime. We got that nailed down to a T. But in so many instances, We are clueless to what's going on. And you know who knows it? Our children. Our young adults. They know it. And that's why they don't have time. Time is one thing that's very valuable. And they're not going to waste their time sitting up in a sleeping church. And I ain't talking about you. You could be making all the noise you want to make. But when you are culturally irrelevant, when you have no clue of what's going on, when you are not aware of what they're dealing with, we get lost in this little box, in this little time capsule, and we want to, how many of y'all know our children don't feel the same way? How many of us, we got this opinion of homosexuality, and we want to put them on a cross, and we want to do them, and we want, how many of y'all know that our children don't get all crazy like that when they hear that?
That's right.
They don't act like the people, you know, they don't know these dirty, no, that's your, they're their friends.
Amen.
So they were dealing with it and are in the midst of it. And so when we sit up here and act as if this is nothing that's a part of the church and act as this dirty thing that we can't touch, they look at us and say, where are you? What century are you living in? You know, we get lost in our little box, and we don't want to talk about issues. We don't want to deal with issues. And they look at us and say that you are irrelevant. You don't even know what's going on in our life. You don't even know what we're dealing with. My son was talking the other day, and actually yesterday, and he was saying something, and I said to myself, now I got to go look that up. He was talking about something. I can't remember what it was. What's this thing? What's this thing? You told me, you said something about, Illuminati. Yeah, Illuminati. He said some kind of comment yesterday about Illuminati or something like that. And I thought to myself, I don't even know what the Illuminati is. I heard it about Jay-Z and all that, but I ain't never took the time to say, I gotta go look it up because I young people are talking about it, young people are they're chatting about it, dialoguing about it. I need to go and inform myself if I'm going to be relevant and be able to reach folk where they are. You can't sit in this little box and I come to the garden alone. I love that song. But we got to go engaged and know what our young people are dealing with. Know the issues our young people are dealing with. The oppressions they're dealing with. And be willing to stand up and speak and understand their language. We got to pray there now. But are we watching? Are we paying attention to what's going on around us? Are we paying attention to the world that's going on around us? Are we paying attention to what they're dealing with? And whether you know it or not, there's some stuff that folk your own age are dealing with. But you just insulated in this little box. You can't see what's going on around you. Where did these opioids come from? They've been there the whole time. As a matter of fact, it was crack in the 80s. But because people were melting in their skin, they were the ones being damaged by that. It wasn't really a big deal. It was a crime. And then it just graduated and graduated and graduated. And then now folk are mixing stuff up. They bring the heroin has come back. And now folk are dying. But the reality is that it's been there for a long time. We just insulated inside these walls. And it's not in our community. But the devil lives a life. It's right next to us. Our eyes are closed. And we're asleep. Folk are needed. We're supposed to watch as well as pray. But the church needs to do their part as it relates to watching. We need to know what's going on out there. I looked at this little girl. She did an interview. I guess she's not a little girl, but seemed like one to me. She did a little interview, and I was actually smiling doing the interview. She was cussing up a storm. I wasn't smiling then, but she was just kind of funny. And then I laid in the side, I was listening to her. Then I realized she got, I think she's a new artist or something like that, and had one, two, or three, I can't remember, some hit songs that's going on. Like the first one, I guess, to be so young that has all these hit songs. But I was listening to an interview, and she had me laughing. And so I got to listen to stuff like that to see how can I connect with my young people. Y'all probably talking about who we talking about. Nice-skinned girl named Cardi B. I think she's from the Dominican Republic. I know she got a lot of filth that comes out of her mouth. But you got to listen close to what them young folks saying. You got to listen close to what's coming out of their mouth. Because you need to know what they're talking about in order to do real ministry. You got to know what they're saying in order to do real ministry.
the juice ain't gonna do no good if I can't get the young folk and even the older folk to partake of the juice. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. He said, you got to watch as well as pray. In verse 41, the second part, he went on and said, he says, otherwise, if you don't watch and pray, he says, you will be tempted and it'll overpower you. Both are needed so that you will not fall into temptation. Did you read it right there? You got to watch and you got to pray to avoid falling into temptation. We got the prayer now, but I don't think our eyes are open. We're not paying attention to what's going on in our world. And we're setting ourselves up to fall into temptation. Well, somebody wants to know, Reverend Rawls, what is temptation? Temptation is opportunity presented by the enemy to lure us away from the perfect will of God. And here the enemy has tempted the disciples with a tool of self-gratification. Basically says, I know what Jesus wants you to do. Jesus wants you to keep your eyes open. He wants you to watch and have his back and be relevant with the things that are going on in our world. But you know, you haven't been asleep in a while, and it'll be okay just to take a little nap. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. Temptation, it lures into a place that takes us out of the will of God and satisfies our personal gratification. Sleeping satisfies me, but sacrifice, it puts me in a place to where God can be glorified. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. I was watching this, so I don't know if y'all seen it before, but there was this little TV show, it's called Blackish, and I like that show because the message is always real deep. There's a lot of sin in this, but the message is always real deep if you can stay focused enough to pay attention. See, sometimes church folk, we are so deep, we can't pay attention long enough to see the message we need to learn. And so from that show Blackish, I realized the other day that now the little girl Zoe, she has her own church and it's called Grownish, and Zoe is in college and she's in college doing what college kids do, and the kids were telling her, hey, all the kids, they take Adderall or drugs to help them focus when they hadn't slept long enough. And first of all, she said, no, I can't do that. But then she had to be ready for a test that she had to pass. She went ahead and took one of the pills, and it helped her stay awake and focused. Her friends looked at it and said, I told you that it would help you stay awake. But all of us got enough sense to know that you don't take drugs to help you focus. It'll make you focus, but it'll mess your mind up and tear your life down. But what I learned from that was something that I didn't know. See, I went to college in 1984. I'm gonna be real with you. We smoked a little weed, but let me be real with you. We smoked a lot of weed, but we didn't do pills. Now we didn't do some other things. But from what I learned from Grownish is that, you know what? Even though it doesn't make sense to me, that college educated young people with so much potential would depend on Adderall and other pills to stay awake and stay focused. I got to wake up and realize that this just might be a norm that our young people are dealing with. I can't ignore it and make it go away. I can't turn a blind eye and make it go away. I got to understand now, how do I preach and how do I minister to young people who are trying their best to be successful, but they're using self-destructive tools to get that success. You can't hide from reality. You can't lie your way out of the truth. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. I learned here that it pays off to not only pray, but I better also watch. My young people might be doing stuff that I don't really be participating in behavior that I don't know that they're doing. I got to watch them and not judge them. I got to try to understand, why is it that you want to do what you want to do? If I start out fussing and fighting, I'm going to shut them down. I got to be open and allow them to teach me. I got to admit that I don't know everything. But the Bible says that not only should I pray, but I also need to watch so I can be relevant in this present age. Somebody say that. There's a hymn that says, a calling to fulfill. And we have to serve God in this present age. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. And I just got a feeling that churches are trying to ignore the fact that things that we once said were taboo are not taboo anymore. I just got a feeling that churches are trying to ignore that drugs are all around us, different kind of behavior all around us. I just got a feeling that the church is unaware that folk don't crucify themselves anymore. When they have a baby out of wedlock, they still are proud of themselves, still look up on themselves. They don't put themselves down. The only ones putting themselves down are the irrelevant churches. And God says today, I need for the church to be relevant, to understand that folk behaves still need to be loved.
Stay in the gas station and have fun in the gas station. see.